concept. Okay? So my recommendation and my appeal to all of you is stop calling all this CHED stuff OBE. Stop calling it OBE. Refuse to call it OBE. What it is outcomes accreditation. It's OA. That's what this book is about. And this book is how to get beyond OA. How to get to real OBE. In practice, etc. So, that's my sort of combined first and second. I'm not trying to sell books, folks. The reason we wrote this is because there is too much confusion and distortion and misunderstanding and misapplication, etc. They are two absolutely different things. OA is not OBE. And OBE does not want to do OA. Okay? So maybe I should have said that very clearly in my presentation, because I do have a presentation that is all about the differences between OA and OBE. So don't call 46 in number 2012, okay, don't call it OBE. In that document, however, way back in Appendix 3, is a confession statement by CHED. There's two kinds of OBE, says CHED. There is strong OBE, and there is weak OBE. And strong OBE is basically, they use the words that describes what we've been doing with role, life role performance OBE, which what I ended with, okay, in my presentation, all right? But CHED has decided instead of doing strong OBE, we're going to do weak OBE. And so they do weak OBE, they don't even do any OBE at all, but they make the distinction. They knew the difference, okay? When they wrote that document, they knew the difference, okay? So my appeal, don't call it outcome-based education. It's not, it's just absolutely not. It's outcomes accreditation. That's what it is. It's accountability driven outcomes accreditation. That's my opinion. Comment. I was intimately involved in the South Africa OBE thing for several years. They absolutely never, ever, ever, ever understood anything about OBE. They absolutely refused to do real OBE. They already had made up their minds about what they were going to do before I ever got there in 1997, okay? And I was asked by one of their major journals, would I please write an article at the 10th anniversary of the implementation of their OBE policy, okay? And I said gladly, there never was any OBE. And they said, exactly, thank you for writing that article. Okay, I don't know what you're referring with about Australia, okay? Because I know in one of the states in Australia, they are doing a lot, okay? And in some of the states, they wouldn't even invite me, okay? So Australia is a complicated scenario, and I don't know where the rumors come from. But South Africa never did it anything close. Now you have the same situation. You have OA masquerading as OBE, All right? And pretty soon, you know, I'll guarantee you, the Philippines will soon have a blazing headline in the newspaper. The Philippine Educators of the Universe reject OBE. And it's because, oh, it's OA. It's not OBE. So, I'm done.
Thank you, Dr. Spady. So any questions or comments?
To be doing OBE. And now, I have these three questions because I work in a senior high school. And I'm talking about the nature of outcomes because I'm working on a paper about the alienation and the cause problem of outcomes-based education. Why? Because we also need to ask, how do we approach these outcomes? For example, when I taught this introduction to the philosophy of the human person, we usually have projects as performance tasks as far as the outcomes are concerned. So, for these outcomes, of course, you have magazines, you have videos. But the problem, usually, when it comes to the production of these videos and magazines, they would involve a lot of money. For the record, the most expensive magazine produced by a student in our school is 1,000 pesos. Now, when it comes to video making, most of the senior high school students are commenting that not everyone is educated on how to make a video. And yet, teachers are imposing these things as an outcome. So I'm just clarifying for this first point because it seems that we are incurring a lot of expenses when it comes to outcomes making. That's why I'm referring to the means of production of such outcomes. And of course, we're talking about the abilities of the students. You mentioned that, of course, it's not time-based. However, we are given a reality that not all students are engaged in making videos. And then, here comes the teacher, of course, I'm a teacher, imposing that you should make videos as part of these outcomes. Second, as we are doing OBE, I think there is a waste of outcomes. Because usually, if the teacher doesn't like the outcome, because of course the student doesn't know how to produce such thing, usually it would get shelved. The teacher would say, don't give that to the accrediting body because it's not a lesson to look at. And that's why, for the third part, for the second part, I'm looking at that waste of outcomes. Because we are producing a lot of outcomes, yet we don't consider these things. Maybe there is something wrong with what we are teaching or how we teach students. And for the third part, I can see the promise of OBE in the extension services of any school or any university. Why? Because we should not just look through the numbers. We should look through the outputs of the students with a purpose. For example, in Miriam College, we already produced books which can be used by students in public schools, which is also produced by students. So it's a student-to-student interaction. And for me, this could be a good promise of OBE because you do not just look for the numbers. You look for something outside of the university. You are looking for a certain purpose. So those are just the three points that I want to raise. So if I want to be clarified with this thing, because for these 2 years that I have been teaching, we were taught that OBE should be this, but I can see that OBE is just simply putting waste into resources because students would spend a lot, they would do a lot, yet they would not be recognized for those efforts. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Ramirez. Any of our speakers could respond?
It doesn't sound to me like your faculty or your institution knows what outcomes are. So my response to one, which leads to two, which is all about three, is that you need some major, major help in defining what outcomes really are and then building curriculum that explicitly leads to the outcomes. That's what I haven't heard you, I mean, what you're saying sounds to me like a case of massive misalignment, okay? and it has nothing to do with, well, we always have them produce videos. I mean, so what is that? I don't know what that, that's more like when and how than what and whether. Okay? So, call us, and you have a flyer about, with my picture on it and Dr. Sampa's picture. Yes? Did you pick up flyers out here? This one? Contact us. I'm serious. He can help you enormously with what sounds like massive confusion within what you're doing. He truly, I'm serious. Okay? He can truly help you. Thank you. Come on, microphones.
Good afternoon. My name is Mr. Bimbay from the Department of Literature. Actually, it's not entirely a question, but more rather sharing of an experience. Way back in 1997, by the time I was about to graduate, under EB, okay, that's in Department of Faculty of Arts and Letters, I actually experienced one thing. I never really went into research, I never really went into thesis making, but my professors actually gave me a revalida. Now in the revalida, I was placed inside the room with the teacher, asking me a lot of questions based from all the lessons I have learned since the third year up until the fourth year, wherein I was majoring in literature. I took it twice because I failed the first time, and the process was actually like this. She was asking me a lot of questions concerning about certain aspects of each of the lessons I have learned, and she was indeed trying to squeeze out of me whether or not I actually learned anything. I'm not exactly sure if it is OBE, because for one thing, I have actually learned something there. But if I'm actually studying, I really need to learn something. Something that I can apply in my life, something I can also teach one day. And then, of course, then came all these researches, all these theses that we usually require students. I don't know what the difference is. It's just that.
Okay. This is the same answer as your colleague behind you. Does anybody know what an outcome is? Has anybody defined outcomes clearly? Has anybody designed curriculum to facilitate those outcomes? Has anybody told the students, this is what we're working toward for 2 years? And the answer seems to be no, 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 and no. So, is that OBE? I don't know. It was some kind of learning experience you went through. It was something a teacher did. Was it OBE? It doesn't sound like it at all to me. Because you had no idea, when you walked into that room, you had no idea what was going to be asked. That's right. So if you had no idea what was going to be asked, how could you have had any kind of clear picture or understanding of what was expected and what you were supposed to do that you could have been working toward? Doesn't sound very OBE-ish to me. That's all. Okay? Thank you.
Yes?
Afternoon, Dr. Spady. I'm J.B. Ignacio from the Department of Philosophy here at UST.
Hello.
I was waiting for something. First of all, I'd like to appreciate your lecture today. I've heard a lot of things about OBE, but there was something I was actually hoping that you could answer. What pedagogy does OBE actually espouse, sir? Assuming that we understand what OBE actually is, what pedagogy should the institution actually espouse in OBE?
Okay. There are four fundamental principles. They don't dictate a pedagogy. What shapes and dictates the pedagogy, if anything, is the nature of the outcomes you're working toward with the students. Okay? If they're of one kind or character, then what you're going to have students do is engage in activities that are directed toward that kind of thing. Okay? If it's simply learning curriculum content, etc., your pedagogy can use those four principles in a very different way. So I said the most, of the three words, outcome-based education. Okay, what's the most important word? I said based, because that's the one people don't understand at all. But I'll tell you, close behind, in second place, is the word outcomes. Okay, they don't understand them, and then they don't understand how you base what you do on those outcomes. That's why I talked about the law of alignment being so critical. That's why I said my colleague, Dr. Sampa, is just phenomenally good at working with people to help bring that alignment into focus, etc., right? Because, frankly, folks, this is not about St. Thomas or any other specific place. The world of education is awash in misalignment. We say we want the students to do this, and we build a curriculum that does something else, and we test for something different from that, okay, and we send in reports about something different from any of that. So the alignment isn't there. Alignment means direct match. It doesn't mean sort of, kind of, related, maybe, okay? It means direct match. And the clearer you are about defining the kind of outcomes you want, and therefore what you really expect of your students, the clearer you can be about outcome design and course preparation and all of the things that are plaguing people right now. So, it takes a lot of work. Real OBE takes a lot of work. It takes a lot of focus. It takes a lot of diligence if you really want to do it right. Okay? So, define good outcomes. Define what kind of things do you really want your students to be able to demonstrate, even with liquid outcomes. Okay? Because even liquid outcomes have a demonstratable component to them. Okay? And that's why, the most discouraging thing to me when I look at the CHED documents is the total disservice that is done to demonstration verbs. It's like, here's some verbs, just maybe use some of these. And the verb in number 46, 2012, the verb that I noticed most often, and I realized we're, as academics, we're all guilty of this, okay, was the verb discuss. Well, folks, I can discuss anything. I don't have to know anything about it. And I can discuss it. Name a topic. And I can just discuss. There are no criteria. There is no indication of, so what are you really looking for? You're just going to have them discuss. And unfortunately, higher education is sort of discussed to death. Without being clear about what you're really wanting to do. Because I know you want your philosophy students to be able to describe things and explain things, etc. Those are observable demonstration verbs. This is not all about rigid performance. These are the things, this is about trying to make more explicit the things we have kept implicit, okay, for far too long. Because once they're explicit, we can then start to do some careful alignment around those things. As long as it's all implicit, we can kind of do anything.
The reason I asked Dr. Spade is because if we go back to CMO number 46, there is always a connection between student-centered and OBE. It would now appear that student-centered pedagogy ought to be the espoused pedagogy for outcomes-based education. And if you look at, well, at least the major colleges and universities here in the Philippines, they all proclaim a pedagogy of student-centeredness. So does OBE actually take a stand about being student-centered?
Yes, thank here you, goes. Doctor. Here goes. Are you ready?
Let's go.
You're my kind of guy.
I'm willing to work for the consultancy.
How do I start this sentence? The last thing you do, if you're going to be student-centered, is to develop a standardized curriculum. If you're going to be student-centered, the last thing you develop is a CHED syllabus. If you're going to be student-centered, students are human beings. Now, what do you want those human beings to be able to do? How do you want to cultivate them? What do you want them to be able to demonstrate? Because that's not, see, all students could learn and succeed, but not on the same day, in the same way. So if you're going to be student-centered, there's got to be a negotiation between you and the students about how we proceed in a rich and useful way here. Okay? You don't do it by creating standardized syllabi.
Thank you very much, Dr. Speedy.
Okay.
Perhaps Ma'am first and then.
Good afternoon, Dr. Spady. Thank you for your very enlightening and insightful take on the OBE. I'm the chairman also from the College of Arts. I was actually relating very much to the observations and the reaction of Dr. Gulamos, especially since design and fine arts is also humanities related. So my question actually is, well, OBE seems is overriding the business of education. It is going to take, for example, UST, a lot of realignment and reformatting of the system as well as the structure to really embrace the essence of OBE. And I think it is very tremendous. While it is very exciting and promising, I think it's very difficult to, it's going to be an uphill battle for us to really implement and take to heart the essence of OBE. But actually, I am more interested in your reaction.
Do you mean my kind of OBE or
yes.
The other OA?
Your strong, well, of course, not the OA, because we have been too much fixated on the accreditation, and we use the OBE for the accreditation tool.
Okay.
So I'm actually interested in how are you reacting more to the CHED, and how are you going to, what are you going to do about it? Obviously, you have noted how the CHED has misappropriated the term, and remember that the CHED are not technical people.
They're what?
They are not really technical people. They are just administrators of the higher education, that they have technical committee to undertake the committees on curriculum. So my question is, I'm interested in actually asking you, what are you going to do about this misappropriation of OBE, and how it's going to affect the accreditation system or culture of higher education?
Okay, wait, don't sit down. Don't sit down. We're going to have a nice conversation. Are you ready? No, come on. Don't sit down. No, don't sit down. Don't ask me what I'm going to do about shit. I want to ask you, what are you going to do about shit? Ched will not talk to me. They won't. They run. So there's not much I can do other than write things like this that truly clarify, not blame, that clarify significant differences. Now, if you and a cast of thousands, okay, don't read things like this and say, we need to bring this to Ched's attention. We need to demand. An influential major university like this needs to demand of Ched, wake up, okay? Look at what's really true. Ask different questions. Approach this differently. Know the difference between OA and OBE, because all you're doing is OA. You have to do that. I can't do it. I've tried. Okay? 3 years ago, on my first trip here, I had a special opportunity to meet with a whole bunch of Ched commissioners and things at a meeting. And I did a very short little presentation. And up on the screen, as soon as I put that life performance wheel, okay, the vice chairman of Ched stood up and said, stop. And I thought, okay, I'm in trouble. Okay? Stop. So, I mean, it's like, really? Stop. Stop. Okay, I stopped. And he points at the screen. And he says, ladies and gentlemen, we have just wasted the last 2 years. When he saw the life performance wheel. We have just wasted. That was in late April, early May of 2015. It's 3 years later, and they're still issuing requirement after requirement after requirement that isn't outcome-based and has nothing to do with the life performance wheel, however that got his attention, etc. So I've written papers, I've done presentations, I've talked to people, etc. I have addressed in these last 3 years, I haven't counted, but I'm guessing that I've addressed at least 7,000 educators here in the Philippines with the basic fundamental things that you heard me do today. Now, if 7,000 people can't carry a message somewhere, I don't know what I'm supposed to do. Okay? I'm just profoundly grateful for this opportunity to talk to all of you. I really, really am. But if you don't carry this forward, it's your education system. All I have is ideas. Okay? You don't have to like my ideas. It's your system. But when you address 7,000 people and they all simply want to get their picture taken with you, okay? And they all want you to sign their book, okay? And they came for the certificate. But I don't know what to do. I don't live here. I come here for a month at a time, once a quarter. I come back and I come back and I come back and I talk to more and more and more and more and more people, and nothing changes. which is why OBE is sort of sinking on my priority list, and I really want to do the program that's in that flyer that I hope you picked up outside, the one about leadership and leadership empowerment, etc. Because it's going to be absolutely different, and there's never been anything like it done here, I am sure. Okay? So, anyway, it's your responsibility. Gather, marshal the troops. Okay? Raid the barricades. Whatever. Storm the barricades. That's what you're supposed to do. Okay. I don't know what else to say. I've made the message about real OBE as real and concrete as I can. Amen. Thank you for staying with me and putting up with me, okay? Thank you.
Thank you, Mel. Yes, sir.
Hello. Hello, good afternoon. I'm Peter Portigas from the Conservatory of Music.
My kind of guy.
We all know that music is probably one of the most OBE.
Absolutely.
Or probably the most OBE kind of discipline. And which contains both liquid and solid outcomes. So my question is more on the element of time. Why OBE should not be time based and all of these things. Yeah. Or probably, am I correct in saying that because I'm bothered about OBE not being time-based because of the finitude of one semester, which is like 4.5 months. So in thinking, because I am bothered with this, am I still on the mode of content-based education? Because of the element of time, we say that an outcome for every student is unique. They do not come all in one day. But the problem is we do not have all year. So how do we, that is quite a challenge for us.
You know, this is interesting because you are talking to a former symphony trumpet player.
I know.
Okay?
Yes.
And someone I was just explaining to a colleague yesterday, okay, that in music, when you learn a musical instrument, okay, you are getting instantaneous feedback on your performance.
Yes.
Every second. Okay? Your ability to monitor and adjust and improve and hear the results, the tangible results of what come out the other end, okay, is instant and direct. All right? There's no schedule on learning to play an instrument well. Okay? There is no schedule on a voice maturing and being able to do whatever a singer has to do. There is no schedule for that. There is none. Now I'm going to tell a story, and it only takes a minute. Way back in the dark ages, when I was 50 years old, I was doing a presentation at a high school. And I realized, and we were talking about expanded opportunity and flexible time, okay? Can you imagine that? And I suddenly had a realization. And I said, folks, do you realize that 35 years ago, right this minute, I was in biology class. And biology was 55 minutes a day, 5 days a week, for 40 weeks. And right now, there are 15-year-olds all across America sitting in biology class. Because it seems like you can't learn biology unless you're 15. Okay? Think about that. Okay. All right? And biology is 55 minutes a day, 5 days a week, for 40 weeks. So the only difference between my biology class and their biology class is that there's 10 times more biology to learn today than there was when I was in biology class. And biology is still 55 minutes a day for 5 days a week for 40 weeks. Because, and here's the bottom line, please take notes. Courses are pre-scheduled events. They are not bodies of knowledge. The knowledge is constantly being compromised to the schedule. Courses last the same amount of time no matter how much knowledge is supposed to be, quote, covered or introduced. So we are captives of the clock, schedule, and calendar, folks. We are prisoners of the clock, schedule, and calendar. And unfortunately, we take on that paradigm thinking. We just think, well, course, okay, of course I teach a course. Yes, I have to plan a course. And the course has to be Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, okay, for 2 hours each day, and the course has a semester at the end, you know, and then the course lasts this long, and then we all quit and go home. So it's hard to have a course when we've all quit and gone home on precisely the right day. The reason, one of the reasons I became so career committed to outcome-based education is because every time I talk about the fact that we are time-based, people go into shock. And I want them to see, we're captive inside of a structure we've created for ourselves. We educators allowed time-based education to happen because it's administratively convenient. It is an instructional and learning nightmare, and it's administratively convenient. Okay? So, as a former professional musician, I sit there and I weep at the fact that in the United States of America, we have literally driven music programs in schools out of existence so that they all take more science and math and science and math and science and math. Okay? And there is nothing more performance-based. There is nothing requiring more complex learning, I mean, mental processing. Okay? And group collaboration, and listening, and adaptability than playing in a musical ensemble, and we've driven them out of existence in my ever so brilliant country.
And to add to that, in most music schools in the West, it's totally anti-OBE, because it's a sink or swim situation. It's either you perform or you don't. That's what we are trying to avoid, but because especially with a discipline such as music, a structured education may kill creativity.
Well, look. here's the dilemma with music and almost all of the other performing arts and all of the rest of it. There are two things about it. Number one, we want to give people deep and rich experiences with the genre, whatever it is. Okay? The other is training people to become professionals. Now, that's where the sink or swim, do or die stuff happens. Okay? There are not enough opportunities to practice one's craft out there in the world, as there are talented people who want to do it because they love doing it. Okay? There are only so many symphony orchestras in any country. There are only so many wind positions in those symphony orchestras in any country, and therefore becoming a professional at some of those things when the opportunity structure is so limited, that's what's heartbreaking. We have improved. We have improved the quality of professional orchestras in the United States enormously over the last 20 years, last 30 years. All over the place. Okay? I live near Portland, Oregon. Okay? The Oregon Symphony, I go to their concerts. Okay? The Oregon Symphony, I mean, Portland, Oregon, is first rate. And that's paralleled by 30 or 40 other orchestras in the United States because the quality of players is so good in the States. And the number of positions is so limited that to get into an orchestra requires incredible talent. Okay? So we are just thriving in wonderful symphony orchestras that are struggling to exist because it's expensive to have a symphony orchestra and have people really be professionals and play at that level. Now, that can go for drama, for music, for art. I mean, it's the same story. Okay? The education has become a utilitarian endeavor, okay, in the last 30 years. It has become utilitarian. If it doesn't get you a good job, why bother? Okay? It's all about getting a good job.
Thank you very much, and thank you very much for the insight that an OBE syllabus should not be industry-based, especially for music, because there's such a thing as, of course, music for itself.
Okay, I want to come back, I want to tie that, however, to the learner-centered thing. We developed a, what we call an action learning pedagogy in OBE, in the States, for high schools and elementary schools. Okay? It worked either way. It had kids being productive learners, doing their own research, etc., etc., etc. You didn't need textbooks and go through textbooks and all that stuff. You didn't need going through all these syllabi. What you needed was a resource map of where to go, where to get good stuff, how to practice it, etc., etc. And that's what we taught people. That's what learner-centered empowerment is about. That's what the new OBE is about. The old one is teach the stuff in the syllabi to the kids. So the whole accreditation stuff is old paradigm thinking about education and learning and all the rest of it. It just is. Okay, amen.
Yes, sir.
Good afternoon, Dr. Spain.
I asked him to ask tough questions, yeah. So here goes. Okay.
I will pick up on your term, storming the barricades.
Storming barricades, okay. There's a concept.
You see, I think the problem in Philippines is that 80% of the universities and colleges, they are private schools. And so they would really require permits from CHED. What I'm saying is that a lot of these, the deans or even the owners of the school, we just have to follow CHED's dictates, even if they are dictating wrong OBEs.
Okay.
And that's what we're seeing. Now, the question therefore I'm asking is that I'm so happy when you mentioned that, storming the barricades. Because in the end, really, when I look at it, that's the best thing that we can do. But could you tell us about your experience? Because you engage with other governments or other universities in other countries regarding OBE. And I'd like to know whether you can share something about if there's going to be a situation where we really have to speak truth to the authorities, who would be leading it? I don't expect it to be the owners of schools or the administrators, but rather, who would be leading it? Would it be the teachers? Would it be the professional groups? Let's say, Philosophical Association of the Philippines or the other teachers' groups? What is your experience on this?
I think you have a unique situation in this country with so many privately owned, as it were, institutions, etc., etc. All right. With that said, I will now become a skeptic. All right. I have yet to see a government that will really support a creative outcome-based initiative because it means too much system change. Okay? It means breaking out of orthodoxy-based educentrism. Thank you for stealing my four R's of rules, regulations, routines, and whatever it is, okay? Because their whole life, the whole governmental existence is built around rules and regulations, etc., etc., etc. That's why they're in business, and that's why they keep you in the context that you're in. Okay? Are you complying with rules, regulations, and all the other stuff? And routines. Okay? So, who's going to do it? Who's going to storm the barricades? If the leading elite institutions aren't willing to do it, if they don't form a coalition and set a different kind of example by what they do, it won't happen. Now, the good news is that 2 years ago, I worked closely with the University of San Carlos on building an outcome framework like the St. Paul framework that you saw. All right? And it has had a significant influence on how that university has organized itself and revamped curriculum, etc. That is surely going to happen in the St. Paul University campuses, etc. So, if you took an institution with the influence this one has, and you partnered up with some of these other ones, you could present quite a case to CHED about creating some experimental sites, creating some model sites where we really carve out a new and different paradigm that others will want to emulate. Okay? Think that way. Build a coalition of cutting edge, high reputation universities who really will have a lot of influence. And let them truly move ahead in a creative way and develop some of these things that aren't getting developed because everybody's in the compliance business. Nobody's in the creation business, everybody's in the compliance business. And as long as you keep complying, they'll keep pushing and demanding more stuff. But if the 10 most creative universities in the country get together and say, we're done complying, why don't you guys open up and wake up and see something different here? Let us do something different, and we'll show you how much more effective it is. I think that's the way to think about it. Because in general, you've created a perfect storm of compliance here in what you've just described. Okay? All these people just want to be sure that they don't make Chad unhappy.
Thank you, Dr. Stady.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Mark Landini, philosophy. One revolutionary change that has to happen is, of course, we should remove deadlines if we are not really time-based, right?
Okay. Let me try this. Okay. I'll do the best I can. Because, see, we're so time-based that the number one issue is, oh my God, what do we do about grades? And what do we do about schedules? And what do we do with all that stuff? Okay? Opportunity ends when you get graded in ink. Now, the question is, are we grading the course or are we grading the performance? Because right now we're equating the two. Okay, the performance has to fall into a specific timeline called a course. Now, there are many ways to provide expanded opportunity, all kinds of creative ways inside of a course and inside of a department for giving students help so that they can improve. That's what this concept is about. That's what principle number two is about. Expanded opportunity when you're making a best effort to, okay, accomplish what's there to accomplish. There are lots of creative ways to do that. I was stunned. I did an intensive week of consulting at the major engineering university of Saudi Arabia. And if anything is structured and everything else, it would be a major university in engineering in Saudi Arabia. And after 3 days of working with the faculty from all the departments, okay, and chemistry and physics and this and that and everything else, we started to come up with the greatest ideas about clever ways they could be creating expanded opportunity and additional learning support for students, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, that wasn't going to cost anybody extra time and wasn't going to have to extend over the years, you know, over the course of a year. But think about incompletes rather than low grades. Incomplete means incomplete. It doesn't mean you give them a D, it means you give them an incomplete. And the responsibility then goes on the student to do the improving within a given expanded opportunity time. Okay? Expanded doesn't mean eternal. Okay? And we kept saying that. Expanded, think of time as a flexible, Bloom called it an alterable resource. Think of time as a flexible, alterable resource rather than as a fixed definer. Okay? That's what has to happen first. Fundamentally. Okay? We've got to start thinking about outcomes differently, but we have to start thinking about time differently as well. Okay?
The effect of that, however, I think the more obvious related word to outcome is precisely, perhaps we have an income-based education. it's very close to it. I mean, outcome, income, what does that mean? They, I think, the outcome-based education, at least how it is presented, doesn't add yet, or doesn't show yet. Their outcome seems to be neutral, and yet there is a gap whether how we would put standards on that outcome such that there should be a high quality outcome or high output. In fact, we had this in our school. There's an old teacher there. I'm not outcomes based, I'm output based education. What's the difference?
Well, I'm not sure what they meant by output based. Okay. where do we start here? Look, income based is kind of the dilemma that Alan was talking about in terms of, well, there are all these owners of universities, and they got to be sure that they stay in business and they're earning money and all that sort of thing, which is just absolutely not the motivation of the educators who work in those institutions. They're not income-based in terms of money. I think they're fundamentally purpose-based, mission-based people. Let me try this. Outcome-based education for me kept me in. Okay, I devoted my life and my career to it because for me, outcomes, when you declare an outcome, you are declaring your purpose. The purpose and the reason we're here